fighter and activist Leila Khaled's image flashed across the world after she hijacked a passenger jet in 1969 and made world history by becoming the first woman ever to hijack an aeroplane. The picture of a young, determined-looking woman with a checkered kaifiyeh scarf clutching an AK-47 was as era-defining as that of Che Guevara, Ruth First, and other political figures from our recent past. Khaled is visiting South Africa at the moment, and as part of her boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement in South Africa, is giving talks for fundraising. She is joining us now in our Durban studios. It's a pleasure having you here on the program. Thank you very, very much for being our guest on the program.
Thank you very much.
Now, you, as we said in the introduction, you hijacked your first plane when you were 25 years old in 1970. What prompted you to do this?
This act was intended to ring a bell for the international community to focus on a catastrophe which is called Nakba for the Palestinians, that happened in 1948. The Palestinians were driven out by force through the clashes and the fight that the Zionist gangs at that time did in Palestine. The world dealt with the Palestinians as refugees who needed human aids, without looking at it from another angle, that it's a political question. Yeah. And it's an important political one. It had never been in history that a people is driven out of their country and some other people settle down to speak about their right for that land. That's why this is a tactic. We didn't use it for long. So this tactic aimed to make the international community ask the question, who are the Palestinians? Yeah. Why are they doing so? And the answer was given by the revolution that broke out after 1967. Yeah. And at the same time is to oblige Israel accept to release the prisoners in that in the two years after they occupied the rest of Palestine in 1967. So it was important for us to speak to the world that we are a people who deserve to be in their homeland, and they should be there to determine their future.
All right. Many call you a terrorist. You obviously dub yourself as a freedom fighter. How do you draw a line? What is the differentiation between a freedom fighter and a terrorist, in your opinion?
I think a freedom fighter is a part of a people who are struggling for their freedom. Many resistance movements in the world, including South African resistance, was described by the West that this is a terrorist act. The most dangerous thing is when it is a state terrorism against the people. What can we speak about occupying Palestine by the Israelis and not abiding by international law to withdraw, and yet Israel is going on with its occupation? This is a state terrorism against the people. So when we speak about terrorism, we speak it in terms of occupation, apartheid. And in Palestine, there is occupation and apartheid system in Israel. This is terrorism, while resistance is a legal and recognized and experienced means for a people to get their freedom.
Yeah. Let's have a look at Palestine and the issues that are happening there. What would you like to see happening in Palestine? Obviously, you call it a human rights issue and wanting to see the best for the people, obviously, of Palestine. And yet there's also differing opinions as to what the people of Palestine actually want. What do you think should happen there?
I think that we have declared our goals of struggle. And the world in the United Nations recognized our rights and had and still there's a committee for the rights of the Palestinians, which is briefly the right for return, the right for self-determination and establishing an independent state, a Palestinian independent state with Jerusalem its capital. Now, we have tried different means, an armed struggle revolution and a popular intifada, another intifada, and then the leadership of PLO went to negotiations and signed accords called Oslo Accords that was with the sponsorship of the United States. And yet Israel did not abide by its signature on that accord, which we oppose. We, as Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, a faction of in PLO. Yet Israel, up till now, did not abide by its signature on those accords and went on in confiscating more land of the Palestinians, building more settlements, bringing more settlers to settle in the West Bank, and also building the wall, which was denied by the international community through the international court in Lahai, yeah. That was 5 years ago. And yet Israel, up till now, doesn't care for the violations that she's it's doing for us, ignoring, neglecting, denying the rights of the Palestinians for return to their homeland. Let me say, how can a people determine, practice their self-determination? They can do it when they are on their land and not outside their land. Yeah. Now there are 6 million Palestinians are refugees, and we cannot determine or practice self-determination while we are outside our country.
Yeah, yeah.
The main issue for the Palestinians and the key issue to solve this long struggle and long conflict is the return of the Palestinians there, and there together we can establish, determine our future, and then this will be solved. Other than that, this conflict will continue. We don't want this conflict to continue forever, because it will bring suffering and blood, and we are not in favor of having blood all the time.
Yeah.
We are in favor of peace, because we are victims of occupation and being outside our country. So it's our right, and we are not asking for too much. We are asking that we should be on our land in because we are struggling for a homeland.
Yeah.
And without a homeland, a human being is deprived from his humanity. So we are defending our humanity. We are defending our dignity as a people who deserve to be on their land and live freely there. So we offered a solution. And yet Israel, backed by the United States administration, not to solve this conflict. And they think that by their power, military power or economic power, they can overcome a people who sacrificed a lot, suffered a lot, yet determined to be free.
You yourself don't even live in Palestine. My understanding is that you cannot actually return there. You live in Amman in Jordan at the moment.
Yeah.
I mean, what you're speaking is from personal experience. It's the reality that you would love to go home.
Sure. It's my dream, and it we're hoping. This is now I'm from the generation of 1948 of the Nakba. Now my children, the second generation, and now we are having the third generation. And all of those Palestinian generations are calling and struggling to be in their homeland. This is a human right. And if the Israelis will not accept that or this solution, but one day we reach to a time where the whole world will be with us facing the ignorance of Israel. Yeah. Now, BDS is one of the tools to face this neglect from Israel. Now, the Israelis are now suspicious about this issue, that BDS is related directly to apartheid, because the world successfully experienced boycott to the apartheid regime in South Africa last century, and helped a lot the people in South Africa to gain their freedom. Now, Israel, when is calling the campaigners for BDS different in different countries, and this is not only because of economical things, but it's the culture that people of the world can use their peaceful means to stop this aggression and to stop this oppression from a state like Israel, which is an apartheid state. Yeah. And no more should be apartheid state in this world, because it's a hideous system, it's unhuman, and we want humanity to be protected by the peoples of the world.
We're running out of time, so I want to just talk about your visit here to South Africa. You've had a relationship with South Africa for many, many years. In fact, it goes back to you having met in meetings with our former and late president Nelson Mandela. There's often been open arms to you and your fight against what is happening in Palestine here at home in South Africa. How do you view the country? What do you hold South Africa in what regard?
We had very good relations since years with South Africa through the ANC and through the times of struggle against apartheid. Now, we're expecting from our friends, whether on the official level or the popular level. Now, on the popular level, we receive a good help, and it's practiced in many ways, that some people go to the places where Israel attacked, especially in Gaza, and offer help to the people who lost their houses, and give them what in their hands to, and the possibility to give what they want to give to our people. And this is highly appreciated by our people. But yet, we are expecting from the government also, and not only the people, although it's important, but the government, I think we expect to take another step, at least on the diplomatic level, that there shouldn't be only one South African ambassador in Palestine, and not in Israel, and not to keep on this Israeli embassy in Pretoria. And this is a higher step towards isolation, isolating apartheid system in that part of the world, which is Palestine.
All right.
So we expect a lot, of course, because in this country, people suffered a lot from apartheid and struggled. And they had that long way to freedom, as Nelson Mandela said, and we have also a long way, but we need our friends to support us in the means that it can help us to reach our goals.
Thank you very much for talking to us here on the program. Leila Khalid, Palestinian freedom fighter, here visiting South Africa. She's currently on a tour in the country as part of her boycott, divestment and sanctions movement in South Africa, doing some fundraising speaking.